This is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another episode of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your podcast co-host. We have a fun episode for you today. It's titled The Three Types of Meetings Every Thriving Practice Needs. Looking forward to sharing this with you today. But before I get to that podcast episode, a couple of announcements to make. First off, coming up shortly after this is published, about 3 weeks after this is published, we have our next Thriving Dentist Masterclass. This is on December 6th from 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern Time. And it's titled Grow Your Practice 10% or More in 2023 and Beyond. We deliberately scheduled this masterclass at this time as a stimulation for you and sharing lots of useful information so that you can make 2023 your best year yet. So if you're the kind of doctor that always wants to be growing, this would be a great masterclass for you to attend. A masterclass is a three-hour course that allows me to take a deep dive into a very specific topic. And of course, that topic will be how to grow by double-digit percentage each and every year. Lots of useful information that you can apply immediately in your practice. Very inexpensive. We make these as affordable as possible. Less than $100 tuition. You get 3 hours of CE credits. Come join us. It's done in a live stream format, meaning you can attend from the comfort and convenience of your home or office. But it's also done live so that you can ask questions and make it as meaningful as possible. I think it's the best of all formats. Convenient, but also done in a live format so we can have engagement. In any case, come join us. You can go to thrivingdentist.com/masterclass to enroll in that masterclass. Our masterclasses do sell out. Even though they're virtual, we limit attendance because I run them more like a workshop than a lecture. So if you're interested, go grab a seat. We'd love to have you come join us. All right, the second announcement I have is we have a returning guest. This is Dr. Pavel Krestev. He's from New York. He's got some great information to share with you about the importance of reviewing patients' health history. I think you'll enjoy what he has to say. Here we go.
Good day, friends and colleagues. Thank you for the invitation to yet do another clinical tip that perhaps you colleagues can benefit from. And today what I'm going to talk about is something very basic that we all learn in dental school from the beginning we enter to the minute we graduate. And it's something that's extremely yet important. And here's what I'd like to do, and I'll recommend this tip for you guys. So when we have a new patient and we take a medical history, it happens more often than we like, I think, where a patient, for some reason, they believe that when they go to the dentist, they don't have to report certain medical conditions to us. And for again, I'm sure most of you have experienced this. Patients often say, well, I'm going to the dentist. Why do I need to write all these things down? And quite often in my office, it happens that a patient comes in, they fill out a medical history, and I check the history, and they don't mark anything, meaning that they're in perfect health. So what you need to do is when you take the medical history and review it with the patient, which is something you really must really do. In other words, don't just look at the paper. Go and talk to them about it. You look at the patient and gauge their age, gauge their physical appearance, and sort of, do they look perfectly healthy to you, or are they someone of age, or someone perhaps in middle age, that really you suspect most people that are, let's say, age 50 or 60 or 70, how often is it that we come across a patient that's in perfect health? I'm sure it happens, but perhaps not too often. So what I like to do is I sit with the patient, and I say, well, gee, I said, ma'am, you haven't marked anything in this health questionnaire. Well, she says, for example, I have a little bit of diabetes, I have a little bit of blood pressure, I have a little bit of this, a little bit of that. Before you know it, the previously blank form now has 3, 4, 5 things on it. So very often as dentists, we have an obligation to take a proper history, Do a baseline blood pressure reading for all your patients, because as we all know, patients sometimes come in for surgical procedures and their blood pressure can be elevated. And it's simply because they have the white coat syndrome. They're scared. They're nervous. So if you have a baseline and you've been monitoring your patients properly, then you will certainly suspect that perhaps today's episode of elevated blood pressure may not be physiologic or just maybe some due to the procedure and to the due to the fear factor. So that's something that you should also throw in there when you're reviewing medical histories, etc. Also, I highly recommend before any surgical procedures, please do a blood pressure check on all your patients without exceptions. Because the last thing you want to do is overload someone with epinephrine that does have hypertension. So that's quite important. I'm sorry about the dogs barking in the background. So in conclusion, just get into the habit of reviewing the medical histories and make sure you inform the patient. You say to them, for example, I know you're here today for a tooth and the tooth is in your head, but I'd like to know, aside from your dental history, I'd like to know, sir or ma'am, what is going on with you? Do you have anything that's unrelated to the mouth that I need to know about? So this way you get them to open up a bit and understand that you're specifically not just focusing on their oral cavity and dental needs, but you would like to ask, what is going on with the general health. This will, I think, save you a lot of trouble, a lot of potential risks that clearly can be eliminated. And when in doubt, what I clearly do is I call the physician and I speak with them. And I say, look, I'm going to be placing 5 implants on this individual. Is there anything I should know about? Is there anything that you want me to avoid or watch out for? So communication and the communication and then some more communication. And don't forget, speak to all your patients and you eliminate problems. Thank you again for the honor and see you guys soon.
Welcome back to the Thriving Dentist Coaching in Action segment. Hello, everyone. This is Naren, your co-host. Dr. Pavel, thank you so much for that wonderful tip and for your support of the Thriving Dentist podcast. I enjoyed your tip and I hope all of our listeners got value from it as well. Let's jump into today's topic, the 3 types of meetings that every thriving practice needs. As many of you know, I run a pretty large company with the last count was around 220 team members. And I still believe in one-on-one meetings because I do believe that when you are having a one-on-one conversation with somebody, you really can get to know them, understand them, and they can understand you. It's so much easier to get alignment when you have these powerful meetings. So Gary, I learned a lot about meetings for my own work, as well as I watch you teach our mutual clients about meetings. So I'm really looking forward to today's episode. And I think the timing of this is really, really important because there's a lot of new people, you know, coming into dentistry, a lot of changes happening in dentistry, like every other industry since COVID. So I think this is a timely episode. I think you're going to go back to some basic principles you have, you know, learned over the last 40 years, but I'm looking forward to it.
You know, if we kind of use that Stephen Covey concept of begin with the end in mind.
Right.
I'll use that concept right here very directly. The end in mind that I'm looking for is, you know, what is a high performance team? What is that? And that's when doctor or doctors, if you have multiple doctors in your practice, when doctor or doctors and team members are all rowing together in the same boat towards commonly defined goals and objectives. Now, that's not going to happen magically. You know, we have to spend some time on developing our team and synchronizing our team, especially if we have new team members. You know, we've talked about this in past episodes before, that most dental practices don't have a very good onboarding process, like say compared to business, you know, where they onboard new team members. And so we have to be productive. We often you know, not by design, but by default, kind of throw our new team members into the fray, you know, put them on the phones and they start answering phones. An assistant all of a sudden is assisting us without knowing a whole lot about our practice. And these team meetings, there's three times of meetings that I'm going to share with you. These meetings can really serve to calibrate and coordinate and synchronize your team so that you're all on the same page. Now, we have to do this practically, Darren. We can't just meet all the time. We have to actually spend time in patient care. Yes. But I believe these three meetings can strike a very nice balance between, you know, our need to take care of patients, but also our need to synchronize and coordinate our team members. So the three team meetings that I think every thriving practice needs, number one, a morning huddle. I'll list them, then I'll go back and talk about each one in more detail. A morning huddle. Number two, what I'm going to call our regular team meeting. In many practices, they call that their staff meeting. Well, I think the words we use are important, and you won't hear me use the word staff. I like to use the word team instead of staff. Words are important. I like to say a staff is either an infection or a stick. Well, I guess if it's an infection, you spell that differently. But you get the idea. So our second meeting would be our regular team meetings, and I'm going to share a format that's worked really well for us and our clients. And then third is likely a meeting that you don't currently have in place in your practice, and that's a semi-annual team meeting, I'll talk more about that as we go. But these three meetings can be powerful in terms of creating a high-performance team in your practice where we're all rowing in the same boat, heading in the same direction towards commonly defined goals and objectives. Naren, if we stick with that analogy, I've been in practices where some of the team members aren't even in the boat. and I've been in other ones where they're in the boat, but rowing in different directions. How's that going to work for the boat? Yeah, not so much.
Not so much.
So we want everyone in the same boat, rowing in the same direction. And it's not going to happen by accident. It's got to happen through intention. Intentionality is very, very important. So let's talk about that morning huddle. Morning huddle is a 7-minute meeting before your first patient of the day. And I've been very granular about describing how long that meeting is. How long is it, Naren?
It's 7 minutes, Gary.
Seven minutes. Yes. It's not 10 or 15. Because if it's 10 or 15 minutes, it's not a morning huddle anymore. But in fact, it's some other variation of a meeting. It's 7 minutes long. And I don't care how big your practice. We have clients that have large practices, and they're able to accomplish this morning huddle in 7 minutes. Now, some thoughts about the morning huddle. Number one, it's more about the people that are on our schedule than the process. There's a little bit of process involved. By process, what I mean, we're reviewing what we're doing clinically on the patients today. So a little bit of that. But it's much more about the people that we're seeing. And we want to look for opportunities in the morning huddle with the patients that we're seeing today on our schedule. So it's more about the people than it is about the process. So we typically start, I recommend our clients start with quickly reviewing the morning huddle, quickly removing the hygiene schedule in the morning huddle. And what I mean by that is your hygienist needs to come to the meeting prepared. And your hygienist needs to know who requires exams in the schedule today and whether they have any unscheduled treatment plans. And they're not going to have time to do that in the meeting because that'll make the meeting drag out. They have to have looked at the digital chart and determine who needs exams and who has unscheduled treatment during as we're reviewing those patients. But imagine that we review each hygiene schedule very quickly. We then go on to the doctor's schedule, and the assistant will review what we're doing. Doctor might call out any unique materials or supplies that they might need that's not common based on a particular patient. You know, that's part of that. We then review any new patients on our schedule today. Typically, the person that took the call is the one that reviews the new patients. So we talk about, you know, who they are, what we know about them. Maybe we know that, George shared that he's a bit apprehensive during his dental appointments. Maybe that's something we share. So we talk about the new patients on our schedule today. If we're under goal, We look for opportunities to do same-day dentistry. So if we're under goal, typically the office manager will say, hey guys, we're $400 under our goal today. Let's look for opportunities together where we could do same-day dentistry on our patients today. If we're above goal, we celebrate that. Hey guys, it looks like if the schedule holds today, we're going to be about $1,200 above goal. Way to go. But we still might look for opportunities to enhance that, especially if the schedule moves at all during the day, as it can sometimes happen. And then we finish that morning huddle with what I think is the most important part of this meeting. We finish the morning huddle. Doctor would say something like, okay, I want everyone to look at today's schedule. So it could be up on a 60-inch plasma monitor where the schedule, or, you know, if you're older school, it could be printed up on paper. I want everyone to look at the daily schedule. And I want you to nominate together, let's nominate, whose life are we going to change today? Whose life, based on the people we're seeing today, whose life are we going to change today? And then we'll together nominate, and it could be something clinically. Maybe we're seeding a beautiful smile design case, and we know that it's going to be life-changing when that patient looks in the mirror for the first time. Or it could be behavioral. Something, maybe we know that a particular patient needs a little bit more support. Maybe something, we know something's happened in their life and need a little bit more support. Or it could be something celebratory, something to celebrate, Darren. It could be a patient that we know, maybe we read about it in the local paper that she won an award and we want to recognize her for that. Or maybe a patient that, like me, is a runner and they just won their age group in the local marathon. We're going to celebrate that with them. So any number of different ways we could choose a patient for whose life we're going to change today. Can you see how ending that meeting puts some intention around it and it really focuses on ever developing a relationship-driven practice?
Oh, absolutely, Gary. I think that last piece of, whose life you're going to change today, I think gives a meaning to like the day, right? Like especially a lot of the people you're going to be working with, your team members, are millennials. And I think the number one thing that drives millennials is purpose. You're giving them purpose. I mean, this is like if you work for Amazon or some other place, there's no purpose. When you're delivering somebody, you're not changing anybody's life. I mean, you're helping them buy more crap. Here, you are literally changing people's lives and just reminding them that, making them feel excited about why they, you know, got up in the morning and dropped their kid off at, daycare and came here. I think this is a very powerful way to start the day.
Let me suggest something you can do to turbocharge this morning meeting, this morning huddle. Let's assume we're doing this with technology. We have a flat screen monitor. Assign one of your team members to have the clicker, to advance the arrow, the mouse. And as you're reviewing each patient, pull up the digital note card where you have personal information about the patient, spouse's name, kid's names, dog name, hobbies, interests, college they went to. Just pull that up. So as we're reviewing each patient, we can quickly remind ourselves who's coming today. And if you're doing it according to the way I've recommended you do this, in the lower right-hand corner of that digital note card, we have a capital letter, a capital D, a capital I, a capital S, or a capital C. And we identify that patient's dominant DISC personality style. And that can be very useful as we interact with that patient through the day. And all that can be done very quickly as we go through the morning. Remember, again, this has to be done in 7 minutes or less. Ideally, every one of your team members is there for the morning huddle. In the perfect world, every one of your team members is there. And by the way, they're not just there, they're ready to go at the start of that meeting. They're not reviewing their records. They've done their homework ahead of time. Now, if you do have team members for whatever reason can't be there at the morning huddle, I understand that. I used to be less understanding about that, Maren. I'm more understanding about that today, especially if there's a good reason. One of the common reasons would be we have a single parent who isn't able to drop her kid or kids off, her children off at Latchkey, because Latchkey isn't open enough, early enough. I understand that. You know what? I can be very accommodating to that. If that's the case, then set what time that team member is going to be there. Assign a big sister, a team member in your practice, that will take notes relative to the team member that can't be there. And the first thing she does when she checks in, she clocks in, she goes to her big sister, and her big sister tells her anything that happened in the morning huddle that pertains to her. So I'm happy making that adjustment to accommodate team members that need a little bit of accommodation regarding their challenges in terms of getting there on time. If they can't get up on time and they're tardy, that's not an excuse, Darren.
That wasn't going to apply.
Yeah. But if they have a legitimate reason, then we'll work with them to come up with an alternate format by coming in at a set time, and then they'll check in with their big sister to be brought up to speed. That's how she's getting on the boat, right? That's right. How she's on the boat. All right. That's the morning huddle. The second form of meeting is what you often refer to as a regular staff meeting, and I'm choosing to call it a regular team meeting. Now, in most cases, an hour a week should be fine. However, we found that when we did ours, an hour a week, it wasn't particularly productive because it was during our lunch hour, and the morning would run over, and then the afternoon would start early, and what was supposed to be an hour would compress, and we'd run out of time. And so I might suggest that you do what we did, and we've suggested this to our clients, make it 2 hours every 2 weeks, same amount of time I'm committing, but make it 2 hours. And what we found is that 2 hour block of time is more productive. And what this is like the business meeting of the office. And so we post an agenda in the lab, and any of our team members are invited to put agenda items, you know, anything they want to talk about on that agenda. It might have to do with supplies. It might have to do with repairs. It might have to do with anything at all. It might have to do with the schedule, like, you know, what's our vacation schedule coming up? It might have to do with that. So this has more to do with the everyday running of our office. And because it's 2 hours, you could even do some in-service training during that regular team meeting. For example, Naren, if you're using digital photos for patient education, one of the things we could do during that regular team meeting, so we have enough time, is we could run a photo workshop teaching all of our team members to take those 6 digital photos for patient education. Now, that's going to be hard to do in a one-hour team meeting, but if you have a 2-hour meeting, that's something that could be done, or an in-service type training meeting. Now, one of those meetings every month, Naren, we review the KPIs, the key performance indicators, and the practice performance from the previous month. So in other words, we track 12 KPIs, and we look at the performance in the practice on those 12 KPIs in detail during one of these team meetings. It takes us about 30 minutes to go through those, about 30 minutes. But that allows everyone to know what worked well last month, and it's pretty much in real time, Darren. It's not happening in exact real time, but it's happening close after the close of the previous month, so it's still really fresh. So we can talk about what worked, what didn't work, what we need to improve. If we have any KPIs that are underperforming, then we can talk about our solutions to get a better result this month. And we do that with the entire team. And it's a great way to make our team members aware of everything that's happening in the practice. Very, very, very powerful. So that's the regular team meeting. And the third format of a meeting that I highly recommend, this is something that we have used not only at LifeSmiles, but we've used it with our clients as well. And that is what I call a semi-annual team meeting. So it happens twice a year. And in the semi-annual meeting, the format would be a morning meeting, a morning work session with the team. So it might be 8 to noon. And then we either cater in a nice lunch or go somewhere for a nice lunch. And then in the afternoon, we do some kind of fun activity together. It's team building. It's connecting with our team members. It's slowing down to actually get to know one another. Doctors, how much do you know about your team members? If we expect them to, you know, behave like a relationship-driven practice, one of the best ways we can do that is we can model that with our team members. How much do we know about our team members? Do we know what their spouse or partner does for a living? Do we know what's going on with their kids? Do we know what sports or activities their kids are involved in? Do we know their dog's name, Darren? How much do we know about their extended family? Do we know their faith? Do we know how they like to spend their time? Do we know what their passions are, their hobbies and interests? You know, I like to think that your team presents a rich tapestry of life experiences. And the more we get to know them, the better we are prepared to deliver world-class customer service and world-class relationship-driven practice. So that morning is a work session. 8 to noon. And the kind of things you might work on in the work session would be more of the big projects, the big initiatives that you want to work on in your practice. Maybe this is the year you're going to incorporate adult orthodontics. Maybe this is the year that you're going to do, you get serious about diagnosing, treating obstructive sleep apnea, OSA. Maybe, Naren, you've decided you want to raise your game in terms of oral cancer screening. So traditionally, you've done things like, you know, the head and neck palpating, and we do that. But maybe we want to bring in some technology like oral ID flashlight to help us with screening. You're not diagnosing oral cancer, but you're screening for it. Maybe now's the time to do that. And we bring those big initiatives into your practice. Maybe we want to do a deeper training in our dental software. Maybe we have some new team members that are still feeling uncomfortable with our dental software. So we do some advanced training on our Dentrix, EagleSoft, Open Dental. Maybe you have Dental Intel and you take a deep dive into how powerful Dental Intel is in your practice. Those are all the things you can do. And notice what we're doing there. We're driving the practice forward. If you do those three prep meetings, morning huddle, regular team meeting, semi-annual team meeting, your practice is driving forward. There's no moss growing under your feet in terms of your practice becoming stale. Would you agree with that, Naren?
I would, Getty. I would agree with that.
Yeah, we're not sitting on our laurels. And, you know, one of our goals, and it's a goal with my clients, and I would suggest a goal for any of our listeners, is simply to be better tomorrow than we are today. Always improving, always growing, lifelong learning, you know, all of this. And these meetings support that. The afternoon play. So what are some things you could do in that afternoon fun activity? Well, I'll just share some of our clients have done. Could go horseback riding if you're in an area that offers horseback riding. Could go horseback riding. You could do iFly, you know, that simulated skydiving. You could do Top Golf. Top Golf is pretty much in every major metro area these days. Naren, do you have Top Golf in Greater Toronto?
I'm not too familiar, Gary, but it might be there.
Top Golf is a fun way to even if you've never held a golf club in your life, it's a fun way to get involved in golf. Bolero is another national chain that makes bowling fun. You could go bowling. You could do miniature golf. You could go to the lake and have an outing on the lake together. It's just many things you do. One of our clients found a local restaurant that's only open for dinner. And during the afternoon, they do private cooking classes. So they enrolled in a private cooking class for the doctor and team. And man, how fun was that? So we're doing things together that we wouldn't maybe normally do. We get to know our team members in ways that maybe, you know, when you're running down the hall and you're grabbing their elbow, we're really not getting to know them, are we? We're slowing down to get to know them. Any number of different ways we can do that. Well, those are the three meetings: morning huddle, regular team meeting, semi-annual team meeting. The combination of those three will result in you getting doctors, if it's plural, and team members all in the same boat, rowing in the same direction. And watch what can happen when everybody's calibrated, everyone's synchronized, everyone understands your vision. And we work on this on an ongoing basis. This is not one and done. We're working on this the morning huddle is happening every day. So in a way, we're improving our practice by daily. If you do every other week, you know, regular team meeting, then every other week, we're making progress on improving our practice. Well, Naren, I know we have some great questions in the Q&A segment. Let's hit pause here in the Coaching in Action segment and go to those wonderful questions.
Welcome back to the Thriving Dentist Q&A segment. Gary, I have four questions for you. Let me start with the very first one. I have tried morning huddles two different times in my practice, and they quickly fizzled out. I mean, they stopped being productive. So we stopped them, right? How can I get a morning huddle to stick this time around?
What a great question. I'm laughing because, Naren, if I had a $50 bill for every time I've heard that opening comment in the question, hey, I've done this a few times and it quickly fizzles out. You know, it's kind of like if you're banging your head against the wall and your head hurts, quit banging your head against the wall. And so the easy thing to do is, this thing didn't work. We don't need to do these. Forget it.
Right.
But I'm gonna make a pitch. And I'm going to make a pitch, and I'm going to do it very specifically. Naren, you know I've made it my life's work to study world-class dental practices.
Yes.
That's been part of my mission and hobby and interest, studying world-class dental practices. And I have to be very careful when I use absolutes. I think all of us should be careful if we use absolutes, like always or never. Rarely is something always, and rarely is something never. But I'm going to use an absolute here because it's been my experience. So from my own experience, I can use this absolute. I have yet to meet a world-class practice that isn't doing a morning huddle. So what does that tell you?
I mean, I think it tells you that if there's one thing you can do, this is one of those one.
Well, if you want to be successful, do what successful people do.
Yeah.
And this is something that successful practices do. They do a morning huddle. So Doc, what I would say, you know, to answer your question very specifically is it's a new day. Don't get mired in the muck. If you've done this a couple times, it didn't work.
Yeah.
What I would say is it hasn't worked yet.
Mm-hmm.
It hasn't worked. Just a simple word that you add to that changes your mindset. So this hasn't worked. What is that? If you don't add the word yet, it kind of makes you think like, I can't do it.
Right.
If we say it just hasn't worked yet. And if you have team members that were part of those previous two experiences, lead with that. Say, guys, you know, we've done this a couple of times and haven't had great success with it. And reality, what's happened is we haven't had success yet with the morning huddle. But I want you to know how committed I am to it. I believe it's going to be meaningful for all of us. I believe it's going to make all your jobs better, easier. We're going to connect with our patients in ways we have struggled with in the past. And I believe it's going to strengthen our practice. And I'm going to ask all of your commitment with me. We're going to have to develop some good habits around this, but let's stick with it and let's make this happen. So it's good leadership. And also, you know, my favorite radio station, Aaron,
WIIFM. Yeah.
What's in it for me? So talk to your team members about what's in it for them. What's in it for them in this morning huddle? Being prepared, you know, being ready for your patients, answering questions proactively ahead of time, you know, in before it happens. Part of the morning huddle is about troubleshooting the day and looking for where the log jams are and proactively troubleshooting the day. So you power your way right through this log jam. So talk to them about what's in it for them. And I would use language like, I want to make your day smoother. I want you to be better prepared. And I want no surprises on our schedule. I think the morning huddle is going to help us a whole lot when it comes to that. And so talk in terms of what's in it for them. Does that make sense, Aaron?
Absolutely. And I was just thinking as you were speaking, why is it that every successful practice you ever dealt with is doing it? And it reminded me of, I study successful entrepreneurs and a lot of people who's built their own businesses and built multi-billion dollar companies. You know, they kind of came to the realization that life is, you know, having good years is about having good months, and good months is about having good days. The morning huddle, I think, is just a way to make sure you're having a good day, like intentional day, like a purposeful day, where you know what you want to accomplish, you think it through in the beginning in 7 minutes, just go and execute. So it just makes total sense.
Your results are not an accident.
It's not an accident.
It's intention, and you're setting yourself up for that with the morning huddle. And, you know, there's another dynamic here, Naren. People that are into continuous improvement, as I know you are and I am and our listeners are,
right,
know the power of habit, And there's some psychology around this that says that if you will do something for 21 consecutive days, just 21 right, consecutive days, it will now go from random to habit, and you've established the habit of that continuing. And it's 21 days. And, you know, that might be a month's worth of work days, you know, in terms of the morning huddle. So just stick with it and keep refining it and fine tuning it to where you develop that habit. And next thing you know, it just becomes like rolling out of bed. You know,
it just happens.
Yeah. Great question, though. I love the humility of the question. I stubbed my toe. I love that humility. Thank you, Doctor, for that question.
Absolutely. Let me ask you the second question, Gary. I like your idea of semi-annual team meetings combined with a fun activity together in the afternoon. Can you suggest possible topics for the morning working sessions?
Yeah, those are in the working session, we really want to do more of the initiatives in the practice, you know, the things that we want to use to drive the practice forward. I use the examples in the coaching and action segment as maybe this is the year we apply we learn about adult orthodontics and we incorporate adult orthodontics into the practice. Maybe this is the year we incorporate obstructive sleep apnea as part of our practice. But maybe it's something we're doing, but we want to amplify. something we're doing in the practice, but maybe we revisit our whitening protocol, Aaron, because we noticed as we do our regular team meetings that we're not hitting our whitening target. So we revisit the whitening system. And Aaron, another one that I know you love, and you see this in our common clients, you see it all the time. What is it that you see when it comes to Google reviews that we see this happening time and time again? What is something that you've noticed among our clients when it comes to really getting serious about Google reviews?
I think the ones who do well with Google reviews, Gary, typically have a morning huddle. And I think they just stick with that habit of like, you know, how do we get a review, ask for a review at least once a day? And that becomes automatic. And then it's just like brushing your teeth. They don't have to think about it. It's part of who they are. It's like, you know, it's
so
just.
We noticed that not uncommon in our mutual clients, they'll come out of the gate with reviews and rock it. You know, maybe this is an office that's been historically two or three Google reviews. And by using our system that we teach, they ramp it up and they're getting 15, 20 reviews. And then we look 4 months later and we're back to two. And I think that dynamic is very common. And it can happen for any number of reasons. One of the reasons is the shiny object syndrome. All right. So in other words, you know, all of a sudden the shiny object was the Google reviews, and now there's a new shiny object over here. And so we dropped the reviews and we did this. It's kind of like the juggler that's trying to keep multiple balls juggling in the air, right? So one of the things you could do in those semi-annual team meetings is revisit the KPIs and the systems that drive the KPIs that are underperforming in your practice and go back to fundamentals, go back to revisiting the system. I think the mistake that so many of us make, you make it, Naren, I make it, our listeners make it. Let's face it, Naren, we are accomplished people. You're accomplished. Would you accept that compliment?
Thank you, Gary. I humbly accept the compliment.
You're accomplished. But I think we also make the mistake of thinking it's one and done. We only have to cover it once and then we're done. Rarely does anything lasting work like that.
Yes.
Nothing is ever one and done in a dental practice. You got to revisit it. You got to fine tune it. You got to go back and go to fundamentals. You know, that's why I'm looking in my office at a wonderful quote and photo I have of Coach John Wooden, you know, the legendary UCLA basketball coach. And there's a wonderful true story about Coach Wooden. When he would meet for the first practice of the new season with his, you know, NCAA championship basketball team, and there would be a couple of new team members, you know, on the team, you know what he would teach them in that first meeting? He'd teach them how to put their socks on. Honestly, a true story. He'd teach them how to put their socks on. And I know, in fact, one of my clients played under Coach Wooden. He said, Gary, I couldn't wait to meet with the Wizard of Westwood. That was his nickname, Coach Wooden, the Wizard of Westwood. And I thought, I'm going to learn all about triangle defense, and I'm going to learn about the latest state-of-the-art offense, and I'm going to learn this and that and this and that. And we sit down, and the very first thing he taught us was how to put our socks on. But why was that important? Well, UCLA was a running team. And you can't run and you can't move fast if you get blisters. If you put your socks on right, you're going to get blisters. So it was a very important detail. So what I would say, come up with some, there's all kinds of things we could do in that, the initiatives, the projects, the things we want to do. And maybe some in-service stuff as well, because we have a longer period of time. But in-service type training with our team is another good purpose for that morning part of the semi-annual team meeting.
Thank you, Gary. Let me ask you the third question. This is linked to the morning huddles. I'm having trouble with a couple of team members being tardy. I know I need to address this individually with these team members, but I also don't want to be too harsh in the current hiring environment. If they left, I may have difficulty replacing them. Any suggestions?
Yeah, I'm going to answer this very bluntly and very directly. We cannot allow aberrant behavior in our practice for the fear that someone's going to leave. It is not leadership. It's not effective leadership to do that. I'm going to use this very playfully. You know, doctor, either you run your practice, you know, in terms of approach and philosophy and direction, or it ends up being kind of a free-for-all. And I'm going to say that a free-for-all doesn't work. And it's okay to have certain expectations with your team members. Now, again, if someone can't make the morning huddle because she can't drop her, she's a single mom, hypothetically, and she can't get her kids to latchkey, then pivot and set up a different time for her to come in. That's fair. That's fine. But if the reason they can't make it is because they're out late the night before and they can't get up in time, it's not acceptable. And you cannot be fearful of someone leaving your practice because, you know, they feel like you're being too harsh. You can't run your practice that way. It's more important than ever to have alignment of our team members today. It's more important than ever. And it's critical, especially if you're going to have a relationship-driven practice. And I'm going to suggest you need a little bit of tough love, a little bit of leadership on this. Sit down with them. You know, there's a great way to do this. We covered it in a book club. Do you remember the book that we did by Ken Blanchard, Naren, that's called The 1 Minute Manager?
Yes, we did.
Yeah, there's a very short chapter, 7 pages long, called The 1 Minute Reprimand.
Mm-hmm.
Can I go ahead and do that for you, Naren, as a way to...
Absolutely.
And this wouldn't be you, of course, Naren, but I'll use you as the team member. And you're the
absolutely
one. This wouldn't be you, I'll be clear. But let's say I'm the doctor and you're my team member. You know, Naren, it's come to my attention that you're having trouble getting here on time. And, you know, I understand life gets complicated sometimes. But first of all, I want to take a minute and apologize. And what I want to apologize for is I haven't been clear to you about how important it is for me to have you here on time. It's very, very important. You know, I count on it. Our team members count on it. And ultimately, our patients count on you being here on time. And if you're not here for the morning huddle, you're not getting the information you need to best take care of our patients during the day. So I apologize for not being clear about that. But what I want to tell you from this moment forward, I want you to know how important it is for you to be here on time. And Naren, I think that when you think about this, you'll realize that I'm making a fair request. And I have confidence in you that you will make the changes necessary so you'll be on time in our practice. I have confidence in you. You have so many good qualities, Naren. And I'm confident that you'll make the changes necessary to be an on-time team member. And I'm also confident that, you know, you'll make the changes necessary so I don't have to bring this up again. Then wait, that's the end of the meeting. It's a 1 minute reprimand. And so part of it is leadership, part of it is making clear your expectations, and part of it is being willing to lose a team member because they don't want to play. I get it. I get the shorthandedness, but there's solutions to that today. We can solve that. But the option of having team members that aren't fully committed to your practice, in my opinion, that's a non-option.
Right.
All right. I'll get off my soapbox.
Thank you, Gary. Let me ask you the fourth question. You have mentioned that during one of the regular team meetings each month, you recommend that we review the numbers and practice performance from the prior month. I have never shared this type of information with the entire team. Do you see any risks in sharing too much information with my team members?
You know, that's a great question. And I understand the genesis of that question. Genesis is, you know, it could be a couple things. It could be that, you know, I'm sharing numbers that I've never shared with anyone else before. You know, and I'm not sure I'm comfortable with that. And I get that. It could also be that, you know, you don't feel like our team members can be trusted, you know, with this information. And I just disagree with both of those approaches. I've found that team members can't help us get there if they don't know where there is. Does that make sense, Naren?
Yes.
They cannot help us. Like, if we don't have a daily goal, how can your scheduling coordinators know whether they've done well or not? If we don't have a goal for the number of Google reviews, then it's sort of a direct, it's like the rudderless ship, you know, is just floating around. You know, there's no direction to it. So I actually think the opposite occurs when we share information with our team members. Now, I do believe that certain information should be private. The category that I think needs to be private is individual compensation. You know, we don't share individual compensation with our team members. That's not a productive, KPI to share. That's not productive. However, everything else I think needs to be an open book because your team can help you get there if they don't know where there is. And if they don't know what the daily goal, I mean, I can't tell you how many times as a coach, I've asked a scheduling coordinator, what's our daily goal? And they'll say, you know, Gary, I don't really know. I think we used to have one and we kind of got away from it. And I don't really know. How in the world can she schedule that? For example, your hygiene schedule coordinator needs to know that our KPI is at the end of the month, we want 92% or more of the available hygiene appointments filled with a butt in the seat. That's the kind of stuff we talk about during the review of the previous month. So it's not all about money and collections and that sort of thing. It's about all the different KPIs. So maybe we look at that and then we talk about, okay, our goal is 92%, but we had a struggle last month. We were only at 85% of filled hygiene. What can we do this month to hit the 92? So it becomes problem solving. It becomes like midstream correction. You know, how do we make a mid-course correction so we get the desired result that we want? And you've got to, if you don't have team members you can trust with this information, then we have a much more fundamental problem. And I would suggest that you likely have team members that you can trust with this. And it's just a matter of opening it up and sharing it in a useful, productive way. And man, I just wouldn't want to do it any other way. When you have a full team, you know, I'm thinking of one of our team members that it's two doctors, 15 team members, particular client I'm thinking of. I'd rather have 17 people shooting for the target and the goal than one or two. Wouldn't you, Nary?
I agree, Gary.
Yeah.
That would be. And I think the power of, this idea of team and, you know, getting everyone aligned is you are not carrying the load by yourself, right? A lot of dentists, I think, feel like it's a one-man show. Like they have to push or pull every single person and be responsible for every single thing. And it can get tiring, not just physically, but emotionally, right? It's really could suck your life out of it. But imagine the opposite. Imagine it's like, I mean, I'm thinking of a world-class rowing team, right? Everyone is just perfect and like on the dot, perfectly coordinated. I mean, that's what you want.
Well, you raise a good question about the burden. Kind of like that Atlas image. We know the image of Atlas, right? Holding the world on your shoulders. I think many of us do feel that way. But again, imagine that burden, if you will, being shared by everyone instead of just on you. Well, that's a good way to wrap up this Q&A segment. Hey, as we come to a finish line in this podcast episode, I want to take a minute, Nary, and thank you. I want to thank your team at Equa. If any of our listeners want to really master the world of digital marketing, I would encourage you to do what we do at LifeSmiles as well as what we recommend our clients, and that's to work with Equa as your marketing agency. If you want to know more about that, you can schedule a marketing strategy meeting. Go to www.equa.com/MSM. It stands for Marketing Strategy Meeting. Well, I want to take a minute and thank everyone for the privilege of your time. Hope you've learned some things when it comes to these three types of meetings: morning huddle, regular team meeting, and semi-annual team meeting. And stick with this. This will be a project that will deliver continued results for you if you'll stick with these three meetings. Thank you for the privilege of your time. We look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride, don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. When you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. when you dream big.